So again, good afternoon. I would like to please welcome Shelly Hod Moyal and Ron Goldi and Yoni Assia. I don't think everybody will introduce themselves. So, and Dudu Holzman, of course. So first of all, it's very... So thank you very much all for joining us. So let me start by pitching a question to our to my esteemed colleagues here. So Avi Simchon, Professor Avi Simchon, started his words by saying that Bitcoin will die soon.
טוב, אז קודם כל צריך לשאול את אבי שמחון אם הוא פעם מתעמק בביטקוין, זאת אומרת, אם הוא יודע בכלל מה זה...
Can we switch to English?
מה?
נעבור לאנגלית? Can we switch to English?
לא, אני מדבר באנגלית, בעברית,
סליחה. בעברית, אוקיי, בסדר גמור.
מקסימום תעשו טרנסלייט. קודם כל, לא בטוח שאבי שמחון בכלל יתעמק אי פעם במה שנקרא... ביטקוין, כיצד הוא נוצר, למה הוא נוצר, הכי קל זה לבוא ולהגיד, ואני בא מהתעשייה הפיננסית, עד לפני מספר ימים הייתי עובד בנק, היום אני כבר משוחרר מההתחייבות הזאת.
דודו, I'll just translate, אבי שמחון doesn't know anything, you just got out of prison, which you call a bank, go ahead, please.
והוא ממשיך גם באותו קו, שהמערכת הבנקאית מתכחשת לכל העובדה של המטבעות הקריפטוגרפיים. עצם זה שאתה לא יכול לקנות היום אף מוצר במערכת הבנקאית שקשור למטבעות הדיגיטליים. אם אנחנו נזכיר ETF שנקרא GBTC, שהרבה מאוד אנשים עשו עליו הרבה מאוד כסף וגם הרבה מאוד אנשים הפסידו עליו כסף, אז אתה לא יכול לרכוש את זה היום במערכת הבנקאית הישראלית, חל איסור מוחלט, והסיבה היא שהם לא רוצים שתסכן את כספך.
Wait, just a second. אבי שמחון still doesn't understand nothing, hasn't learned anything, and Israeli banks are following that pattern, and I have a bank account, so I'm... And they're also wacko. Go ahead.
טוב, אז בגדול... Okay. בגדול אני חושב שאם אנחנו נלך רגע לעולם ההשקעות, אז אני חושב שכל מי שנמצא היום בעולם ההשקעות וכספו נמצא בין אם זה בקרן השתלמות, בקופת גמל, בקרן פנסיה או בתיק אישי, אני חושב שהוא חייב להחזיק החזקה מסוימת קטנה, אוקיי? נוכח מה שאני מעריך, לאן שהשווקים בעצם הולכים ולאן העולם הולך, שיהיה לו לפחות נגיעה מסוימת או קשר מסוים לעולם המטבעות הווירטואלי, כי בעצם זה איזשהו סוג מסוים של ביטוח, שאתה יודע, אנחנו קונים ביטוח למקרה קטסטרופלי, ויכול להיות שיהיה קטסטרופה בעולם, ובסופו של דבר זה יהיה הצד המנצח.
Okay, okay so put some of your money in Bitcoin if you don't want to be poor in 20 years, and put it in eToro.
Yeah. So Ron Goldi is not only a translator.
He used to work for 1 hour translation when I was a student.
Oh, that sounds great. He also is the CEO of Firsto. Ron Goldi, what do you have to say about Avi Simchon's words?
Well, I couldn't put it better, obviously, than Dudu, so I'm not even going to try. I'm just going to say what I keep saying all the time. People just don't give this thing a chance. Like, it's only 10 years, right? People have been talking about AI from 1957, right? And we still don't have computers giving lectures instead of Avi Simchon, right? And email was invented in 1972, and by 1992, 20 years after, there were like maybe a million emails a day. Today you don't even want to open Gmail, right? Because you know you're going to get spam from any one of us here. So I'm just saying he needs to maybe give us time and maybe a little bit get educated.
So next question goes to, he needs a hand. Yeah. So next question goes to Yoni Assia. Yoni Assia is the CEO, of course everybody knows him, but he's the CEO and the founder of eToro. SEC. Declined a few ETFs the past few years. One of the excuses that were used is that the Bitcoin and cryptocurrency markets are they have a lot of manipulations in it. So can you please say what your opinion about that?
So I won't speculate whether there's going to be an ETF, but for people who don't understand how the markets work, the SEC, because we're all excited about blockchain and transparency of blockchains and the fact that we can all see the blockchain, the American capital markets for the SEC basically are all already like a blockchain. They actually monitor every single transaction there. So when a hedge fund manager actually buys something and they need to find out whether he bought it because of insider information, they actually get that data. They actually have access to vast amount of data actually connected to whoever does the trades. And that's how they control the system and know to basically protect it for manipulation. So when they look at crypto and they look at all of these exchanges across the world where they don't have control and will probably never have control, then they understand they can't necessarily control the price or manipulation of the price. And for them, that's a new paradigm. I think, by the way, the fact that they trade futures on it helps a bit because the future markets have good market surveillance on it. But they can keep delaying this, especially now, because generally a lot of the people who said, crypto is a bubble and people are going to lose their money are now the smart people in the room because they were right. So those people now get the credit to actually delay things a bit further. So I think it's going to take a while before we see an ETF, but you never know.
Shelly? I'll introduce Shelly. Shelly is a founder.
I'll introduce myself because I saw that my title was a little bit weird. I'm the co-founder and co-CEO of iAngels and also one of the founders of iCapital, which is basically our blockchain investing arm. So I actually agree with Yoni. I think it's going to take time until we see ETFs, at least from what it looks like from the discussions of the regulator. Personally, I mean, I'm not sure that even when and if ETFs will come, whether it will be this quarter, next quarter, end of the year, I'm not sure that I would get as excited about it as a lot of people are, thinking that just the fact that the SEC will approve an ETF that all of a sudden it will generate all this demand in the asset class. I think there are a couple of other things that need to happen. But yes, I agree that probably going to take some time.
אני רוצה להגיד משהו אחד לעניין של הרגולטור. וזה בהקשר למה שקרה בחודש האחרון, או יותר נכון בשבועיים האחרונים בשווקים, שאני חושב שהמניפולציה הכי גדולה זה המניפולציה של הבנקים המרכזיים הגדולים בעולם. קח את הבנק המרכזי היפני, למה בעצם לא רוצים ETF על ביטקוין או על מטבעות דיגיטליים או על מוצרים שקשורים לזה? כי לדוגמה, הבנק המרכזי היפני מחזיק כמעט 100% מכל תעודות הסל על המדדים המובילים בבורסה היפנית. אתה שומע טוב? הם למעלה מ-20 עד 30 שנה שולטים במרקט, ואתה לא רואה שהמרקט רץ כלפי מעלה. נכון שהוא עשה עכשיו תיקון, אבל הם בעצם עושים את המניפולציה הכי גדולה בשווקים.
Central banks don't want ETFs because they now scam the market in the normal industry, and an ETF will be a problem for them.
Yeah, I think that sums it up. So Shelly, let's ask you the next question. We've seen a lot of ICOs the past year, and the SEC started putting some limitations on it. Do you see any future for utility tokens?
So I think actually in the previous panel, Adi explained it quite nicely that that there's a conflict between users and investors and entrepreneurs where it comes to utility tokens. Basically meaning that, you know, at a steady state of a product, assuming a product is successful, in a high velocity environment, then users gain and investors lose. And the activities that we've seen in 2017, 2018 is mostly people that are speculating on these utility tokens. But the fact of the matter is that none of the projects that we've seen have actually been able to kind of thoughtfully design a utility token that works as an investable asset. I do think that what is interesting is kind of cracking the capital formation model so that people like me will continue to be able to invest in blockchain projects and utility tokens. And people have been dabbling with this for a while in mint and burn and governance structures and different type of structures. And by the way, very legit projects like Ethereum, 0x. For me, the most compelling model today is a model that combines equity and utility, meaning that investors invest in, you know, equity or some sort of security and align themselves with the team, and the users get a utility token. And we've invested in several projects along these lines, like Saga, like Space Mesh, and there are also other projects that are doing this, like Sia Coin. And I think that this is the most relevant way now to raise money for a utility or a decentralized project.
Ron, you had something to say about that?
Well, it's a panel, so I guess I have to disagree with you, Shelly, but I actually agree, so maybe we should go on to another question.
Okay. Thank you for your kind
enthusiasm.
Yeah, thank you for your... Okay. So, Ron, you're developing... developing custodian services.
Yep.
Isn't custodian service a way of taking decentralization and centralizing it again? Isn't that the reincarnation of a bank?
No, I think, again, to be 100% honest, people talk a lot about custody in blockchain, and you got to understand, custody in the real financial world, or not the real world, the current world, is usually due to regulation, right? You don't want the cat to look at the milk, or however you translate it. I wasn't that good at that job. But today, custody in crypto, and Yoni, I think you'll agree, it's actually cold storage because people are afraid to have their assets in a hot wallet. And custody today is just a tech solution. It's not really custody. We still don't have, like, I don't know, 1,000 hedge funds that the regulator tells them you gotta have custody. There's tons of hedge funds, there's 900 hedge funds today. They're not obligated to use custody at all. Custody today is only because where this technology is at its infancy, and we're really scared shitless of people stealing the billions of dollars Yoni is holding. And just for you to know, and I have his private key, but yesterday, and this is scary for blockchains, and you know, one of the questions you asked us before the panel was, what's the biggest risk you think, for this industry? And aside from countries saying that banning this or something like that, one of the risks I see is a country, like let's say North Korea, hacking a major blockchain, and due to that, other Western countries say, you know what, it's so hackable, there's, I don't know, a lot of game theory hacks that you can do, we're gonna say that regulatory, this has to die. And yesterday, I met, I had a sit down with David Chaum, and I actually just wanted to say that. But he's developing a blockchain that is supposedly quantum resistant. And I think that's something that not a lot of people are thinking about. So back to your original question, no, custody is not about creating a new bank. It's just about helping people in the current state of technology to keep their assets safe.
Yoni?
I have to disagree with everything he said.
Yes.
No, but I
closing
think,
my eToro account.
I think generally, probably most people here in the room can sort of hold their Bitcoin on a hardware wallet and sort of want control over their keys, but most normal people do not want control over their keys. Okay? First of all, I lost a laptop with my original private keys, and that was not a nice thing because I forgot to back up that laptop. And second, for I guess a lot of people here in the room actually do these mechanics of moving it from the hardware wallet in their home and their safe to the exchange and moving that to another place. That's not a very good thing for people in banks, for example. So people in banks need to treat this like a regular asset, and they want to have a third party that actually safekeeps their assets and potentially also gives them insurance, which is very important. And there's a very big difference between traditional financial services, and that's probably the biggest risk, is not necessarily like cyber risk. 51% attack like yesterday on ETC is a big issue, but the actual cyber risk, the fact that you run a company that's like, nobody can hack a bank like Bank Ben Leumi and steal $1 billion and get away with it, because it's all like a circle of trust. The money moves in T+2 between three different places. They can reverse the transactions almost by definition. In crypto assets, you have that risk that if somebody actually takes your private key and moves the money, it's done, it's gone. That's a level of cyber risk that simply does not exist today in financial services, period. Like, all the cyber units of all the financial services companies in the world are now at risk, like two. Taking them to to crypto assets is like moving to risk level 8 or 9. And that's a very big shift, because they need to have reliance on other, because they need to protect their jobs.
Do you see unique risks related to cryptocurrency, things that governments or banks should look at?
זו שאלה טובה.
Thank you.
קשה לענות על זה, כי אני לא רואה כרגע את המערכת, אני יכול לדבר כרגע רק על המערכת הפיננסית הישראלית, נמצאת במקום הזה. אני חושב שהיא מאוד מאוד מפוחדת, היא מבוהלת, היא עברה חוויה לא נעימה עם הרשויות האמריקאיות, ועדיין ישנם שני בנקים גדולים שלא סיימו את הפרשה הזאת עם הממשל בארצות הברית. לכן, בטווח הנראה לעין, אני לא רואה את המערכת הבנקאית הישראלית מתקרבת לעניין הזה, עוסקת בזה, נכנסת לזה, נוגעת בזה. אני חושב שכרגע זה מחוץ לתחום.
שלי.
I kind of agree. I mean, if you ask me what are the risks today, I mean, it doesn't feel like there are any risks from cryptocurrencies, because nobody cares about them and everybody thinks it's a scam and everybody thinks it's worthless. I guess the only risk, again, would be like a network that actually built something like Bitcoin. If someone hacks it, of course that would be a risk. But aside from that, I mean, even if you think about kind of the Dow and everything that happened in 2016, I mean, this is a market in infancy, so people expect things to go wrong, and there is, in general, a lot of inherent risk within the system. I think that once that risks, real risks for the industry, as an industry, will start to arise after there's kind of mainstream adoption, and then we really need to think about how we protect these assets. Kind of to yep. Goldi's point.
By the way, I don't think we should really blame the banks for not enabling crypto, because eventually crypto is a bank killer. Like, even the Central Bank of Israel potentially rightfully creates this blockade, because it is inevitable that in the next 5 years we're going to see at least one country where people flock to Bitcoin, all the banks in that country go bankrupt, and the government has zero chance of reviving the banking system, because there's no need anymore for the
Venezuela.
Local currency or the local bank. Now, this is a catastrophic scenario for a country, if you think about it from the government point of view. It's not necessarily bad for the people. Potentially, it's better for the people. But it's inevitable, because once people withdraw money from the banks, and let's assume in this scenario, crypto starts going up and their fiat money starts going down, right? And that accelerates. So more people take money out of the banks. Banks are based on fractional reserve system, which means they start going bankrupt. The country can't issue more fiat money because it doesn't help. And that's inevitable. So we're going to see it. You can argue whether some countries in Latin America, you already start to seeing this happen. But it's an inevitable sort of progress of the crypto community to lead some countries to bankruptcy. So the fact that some of them are blocking it actually does make sense. Whether or not fiat money should live in coexistence with crypto it will probably live in that coexistence. But again, the average lifespan of a fiat currency in the world is 30 years. So we're all going to live and see fiat currencies disappear.
I want to follow up on the risk question to you, Shelly. Some of your ICOs have raised money with raised capital with tokens and cryptocurrencies. And the question is, how do they manage the risk of losing all of their money because of an operational thing or glitch?
Well, I mean, they're humans, so I guess everybody's kind of susceptible to making mistakes and not being responsible. And of course, that's a risk, but it's more of like an idiosyncratic risk of, you know, me investing in a company and worrying about my entrepreneurs not being responsible for their funds or not managing their treasury properly. But by the way, I mean, for me, this is what we call tzarot shel ashirim, problems of rich people, that the entrepreneurs that we funded are sitting on so many piles of cash that they don't know what to do with it. And by the way, I think that this is one of the biggest opportunities in crypto today, that you have these ultra-talented entrepreneurs that have these very, very, very well-funded projects in tens of millions of dollars. And basically, they have all the time in the world to focus on shipping rather than raising the next VC round. And by the way, most of our business, iAngels, is in VC. And the way it typically works is that we give entrepreneurs money that lasts them for 18 to 20 months. And so if they don't hit their milestones in this time frame, they're basically out of business. So this is a huge advantage.
So we've talked a lot about risks. So let's talk a little bit about vision, and we'll start with you, Dudu. Hey, how do you see cryptocurrencies and cryptocurrency assets evolve in the next 5 years? What will be the main trends that we'll all talk about?
הזדמנויות, אני חושב שיבואו בתחום הזה של המטבעות הדיגיטליים, כאשר הביטקוין הוא המוביל בהם, כאשר אנחנו נראה קטסטרופה. והקטסטרופה תבוא דווקא מכיוון הנכסים, כלומר משוק האג"ח, משוק המניות, משוק הנדל"ן. כל מקום היום נגוע בבעיה הגדולה ביותר בעולם שנקראת אשראי. התנפחה פה בועת אשראי בעשר שנים האחרונות, במקום שתיעצר, היא גדלה. היא גדלה לממדים הרבה יותר גדולים מאשר היא הייתה בשנת 2008, שמרכזה הייתה בארצות הברית. מה שאנחנו מכירים, הסאב-פריים. לכן, כאשר, גם כשאמרתי היום ששואלים אותי איך אני מתגונן בפני הסיכונים שישנם היום, אז אמרתי שחייב מי שרוצה להתגונן, מעבר לזה שאתה רוצה להיות בטוח, אפילו שאתה יושב על מזומן, שלא ייעלם לך הכסף, אתה צריך להיות באחוז מסוים קטן מאוד בעולם הזה שאנחנו מדברים עליו, שהעולם של המטבעות הדיגיטליים. ואני חושב שפה ישנה הזדמנות. אם אנחנו מסתכלים רגע על עניין ההשקעה באותם מטבעות, כפי שחווינו בעצם בשלוש-ארבע שנים האחרונות, שראינו את הזינוק, ונותן את הביטקוין כדוגמה לכך, שהוא רץ לרמות של 20 אלף דולר פר ביטקוין אחד, והיום הוא נמצא ברמות של 4,000, אז אני חושב שדווקא היום, בתקופה הזאת, זה באמת הזדמנות טובה מאוד ונוחה מאוד להיכנס לתחום הזה, במחיר הזה, ואני חושב שזה מהווה איזושהי הגנה מסוימת בפני הקטסטרופה שעלולה אולי לקרות, שאני דווקא חושב שאנחנו נראה איזושהי קטסטרופה שאני לא יודע להגיד מה תהיה עוצמתה במהלך השנתיים-שלוש הקרובות, אבל האשראי, שוק האשראי הזה, הבועת האשראי הזאת שנוצרה במהלך העשר שנים האחרונות, ברגע שהיא מתחילה להתפוצץ, היא תעשה גלי עדף נוראים ביותר, ואני חושב שהמפלט יהיה בין היתר במטבעות הווירטואליים, כשהביטקוין הוא המוביל בה.
Can I offer my translation services? Because this was actually really good. So Dudu said, and you said it, I'm going to try to summarize it. He said the opportunities are going to happen once the normal fiat world and bonds and derivatives and basically the credit bubble that has created in the past 10 years is going to burst. But I have a question. I'm sorry for hijacking the panel, but this is what I'm known for. So I have a question, which if you've noticed recently, the things that are growing the most in this bear market are actually loan providers, right? So Gemini provided $700 million worth of loans, and you see BlockFi, I think, got like $50 million from Mike Novogratz, and they're saying that they're growing like double digits monthly. And I'm just asking my fellow crypto peers here, aren't we, by creating a lot of super sophisticated financial instruments on cryptocurrencies and not actually taking blockchain to real world usage like we really wanted to, aren't we creating another weird bubble?
So I actually think, similar to Dudu, I think of Bitcoin similarly. It basically is an alternative monetary system. And it's the first layer of that alternative monetary system. And I believe that eventually it will win because it has the best technology in terms of the fact that it can't be controlled, it can't be hacked, you can't just print money, it's portable, and you know, several other reasons. Now, if you're building an alternative monetary system, you have to build on top of that layers and financial infrastructure. And I actually think that credit is one of the largest opportunities, given that a lot of people are, well, I guess not a lot of people in terms of what I expect in the next couple of decades, but one of the most important aspects of building a monetary system is to have this credit. So this actually creates a huge opportunity for people that are passionate and understand crypto and also understand credit to provide and allow for people to get leverage or to create loans against their holdings.
It's actually interesting for people who don't understand what's going on now in the market. So a company, let's say a custody company, took from clients $100 million, then it goes to one of these companies. You can go to these companies and say, okay, clients deposited $100 million with me, and I'm supposedly their custodian. Now I can loan this to somebody else and get 7% interest rate. So that's the loan company, which are now paying 7% because they're giving it to somebody else who actually sells it in short in the market and destroy the values in the market. And that's what, like, a lot of what's happening right now are these cycles, which is super interesting because it's classic Wall Street. And I think what's interesting is, like, a lot of the crypto community are moving from this, like, positive view of this is a great technology, it's going to change the world, to more of the dark side view, which is, well, eventually all banks are going to go bankrupt. There's a catastrophe coming where bonds and stocks are going to get down. So use Bitcoin as a safe haven, which is a very interesting theory. The risks is also already everybody, all the people here basically creating that, right? So it's a self-fulfilling prophecy. So if everybody thinks banks are going to go bankrupt, the markets are going to go down, we're actually, so the crypto community might actually lead us towards that, which is quite interesting from a game theory perspective.
Well, this is quite optimistic. Yeah, Dudu.
אני רוצה רק להוסיף משהו אחד לעניין של, אני לא אגיד קטסטרופה, אבל אני אגיד, כי התייחסת לנושא של השיטה המוניטרית, ואני אצטט את חנן, כי חנן נתן הרצאה מצוינת בוועידת גלובס בעניין הזה, שהשיטה המוניטרית הנוכחית פשטה את הרגל. והדפסה נוספת של כסף לא תעזור ולא תפתור את הבעיה, ולכן אני חושב שהמטבעות הדיגיטליים, העולם החדש הזה שאנחנו קוראים לו, אני חושב שהוא בעצם בא לתת מענה, והוא נולד כתוצאה מהמשבר של 2008.
So, to sum up this panel, I would like to take a few questions from the audience, if the audience want to, does anybody want to ask something? No? Okay, so I would like to thank everybody for this panel, and thank you very much.